Debbie and I are so excited to re-announce our second Women of Worth conference here at Community Alliance Church.
Yes, Donna, we're so excited because the heart of Women of Worth is to encourage connections with women of our church while connecting with God, a way to build relationships beyond Sunday services. We want to grow together as a church community, and this year we're excited to dig into cultivating relationships with God and others.
Women of all ages are invited to join us for fellowship, food, worship, and teaching from God's Word.
We're looking forward to spending the day hearing from women of our own church, including our pastor's wives.
Whether you're in your teens or in your golden years like me or somewhere in between, everyone's invited.
We are definitely taking extra precautions to make the day run smoothly while helping everyone feel as comfortable as possible. We'll encourage social distancing where we can, and we'll also have a pre-packaged fresh lunch for everyone.
Space will be limited, so be looking to register soon online and in the lobby between services. We look forward to seeing you there.
Okay, here's a question. Do you believe you have a personal responsibility to share your faith? Surveys have shown that the overwhelming majority of you would answer yes. Okay, so what about this question? Have you shared your faith with anyone in the last 6 months? Surveys have shown that a majority of you would answer this question? No. I guess it's just not as easy as it seems, or at least as easy as we'd like it to be. Well, here's another question. How many times have you personally invited an unchurched person to church? Now, this seems simple, right? And yet, surveys tell us that almost half of you would answer zero. I mean, there are lots of reasons why we don't, right? Like, maybe it still feels a little awkward and uncomfortable. Or maybe we're just unsure how effective it is. Or we just expect to hear them say, well, no. Okay, so listen to this. When people are asked why they came to church in the first place, the vast majority of them say, I began attending because someone invited me. It wasn't the music or the pastor. It wasn't the childcare, the youth program, or the building. Although these are all great things, important and valuable things, the main thing that got most of you up and through that door the first time wasn't any of these. It was an invitation. Easter will be here soon. It's the perfect Sunday to share with others what your faith is all about. And it can all start with one more simple question. Want to come to church on Sunday? Let's change the stats and let God change hearts and lives this Easter. And let's start with something simple, an invitation.
Good morning. Really glad that you're here this morning. Just want to welcome you to Community Alliance Church. Sunshine is out, so we're glad that you're in here for now, but hopefully you can get out and enjoy it later in the day. If you're here for the first time or maybe the second time, you've never filled out a Connect card, we'd love to have you do that. You'll find them in the seat back in front of you. And if you're watching online, you can fill out a virtual Connect card. It lets us know a little bit about you. If you're here in the service, you can take it out to our Welcome Center online. If you send it in, we'll reach out to you as well. So please take an opportunity to do that. Also want to let you know about our Easter services coming up. There are four of them. The times are different, so please pay attention. As you show up on a normal time, there may or may not be a service going on. We have four services. They're going to be shorter so that we can get more folks in. Could you RSVP for that? We would really appreciate that. That'll help us kind of spread folks out and make sure we have room for everyone. I also want to let you know we're going to be taking communion this morning, so on your way in, hopefully you were able to get a communion cup. If not, you can go out and get one. If you're watching from home and you want to participate in communion, all you really need is some bread or a cracker and some juice, and you'll be able to do that with us later in the service this morning. I also want to tell you that the offices at Community Alliance Church, starting this Friday, the offices are going to be closed on Fridays. We are doing that so that we can all the team can be together 4 days of the week, kind of work more efficiently and effectively. But what we want to let you know is that if you call the office on Friday, there'll be an instruction to tell you very clearly how to leave a message. And there's going to be a pastor on call every Friday so that when you leave that message, someone will get in touch with you very quickly. We want to make sure that we're providing the pastoral care we need on Fridays as well as the rest of the days of the week as well. This morning, we want to spend some time worshiping the Lord. But before that, would you pray with me? Father God, we come to you and we just come into your presence and ask, Lord, that you would remove any distractions and that whether we're at home, whether we're in this place, you would give us the ability to focus on you and worship you and give you praise. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. If you're able, would you stand with us this morning and worship with us? Thank you.
Let's sing together. You called me out of darkness. You silenced every lie. Oh, you called me out of darkness. And you silenced every lie, and no other voice will define me, 'cause I belong to you, 'cause I belong to you.
Sing that again.
Oh, you called me out. You silenced every lie, and no other voice will define me, 'cause I belong to you, 'cause I belong to you.
The enemy can't.
Take what I have and change who I am. My His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. What love could remember, no wrong we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. We stood beneath the debt we could never
says Christ Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God, that He existed before anything was created, and He is supreme over all creation. Paul goes on to say, for God in all His fullness was pleased to live in Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Last week we shared with you all a brand new song, and this morning we want to sing it again, that just puts Jesus at the center. He is the focus of our lives, of our worship, because of his great love for us at Calvary. Let's continue to worship together. Let's sing, "There's a Name."
There is a name who reigns without contention, whose power can't be questioned or contained. With humble faith, he rules the earth and heavens. His glory knows no measure or refrain. And it's bursting past the borderlines of space.
Sing, "Jesus."
Jesus, and broke upon the praises of our hearts. Jesus, you're the King and you're the center of it all.
There is a name.
There is a name. Reaching past the margins, calling sons and daughters back to him. And as he says, we can hear the roar of heaven as prodigals are coming home again. Oh, the triumph of his name will never end.
Oh, Jesus,
Jesus. Oh,
stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. People
said, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. I am so excited to be here with you this morning. I've been looking forward to this all week long. If you're watching online, thank you so much for spending some of your time with us. And as you saw from the video, we're jumping right back into our Jesus is Greater Than series, our study from the book of Colossians. And in this letter that Paul wrote to this little church that no one would have actually ever heard of if he hadn't written a letter to them that was saved for us to read in our Bibles today, we see that Paul is saying to them, despite the problems that you think that might be bigger than you, always remember, Jesus is greater than. So this is week 3 in the series. I just want to encourage you, if you've missed any of the messages and you want to go back and get caught up, they're always going to be available on our Facebook page and on YouTube. As we get diving in here this morning, though, I just want to encourage you, would you join with me in prayer? We're going to go to the Jesus who is greater than and ask for him to be our teacher and help us understand his word today. Jesus, we do come before you. There's truth in your word that can change, literally change our lives. And so, Father, we ask that you will speak your truth today. May the words that I say be your words. If there's anything that I say that isn't from you, may it be quickly forgotten so that your truth comes through loud and clear, not just to our minds, but to our hearts, that affects our actions as we leave this place. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, so have you ever heard this noise before? Bzzz, tap, 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 tap. Bzzz, tap, 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 tap. I'm in one of the rooms in our church a few weeks ago trying to get a little bit of quiet so that I could study, and all I could hear is the incessant, unsuccessful attempts of this little housefly trying to make its way through one of the church windows out into the world of freedom that it could see beyond. And as I'm trying to concentrate, all I hear is bzzz, tap, tap, tap. Bzzz, tap, tap, tap. If it's annoying to you, trust me, it was way more annoying to me because I just realized every tap was one more unsuccessful try to escape through the window of glass, and every buzz was just a little bit more desperation, a little bit more trying harder to get through. And all it was really accomplishing was annoying me. So I decided I'm gonna go and end its misery in mine. So I pick up my book and I pick up something, and I go over, I found the window, there's the fly, and just as I'm about to swing back, in my backswing, I stop because I notice something. On the top of the glass, on the top of the window sash, there were about a dozen other dead flies. And I realized that all of these other flies had spent the final moments of their lives trying to break through a glass barrier that they didn't know was there, and they probably didn't realize that they couldn't overcome. And then I had a tender thought. It wasn't, well, am I about to make an orphan family of flies? I'm not that tender. It was this. What would it be like to spend your whole life up against a wall separating you from freedom, condemned to death because of it, and you didn't even realize it was there? Well, this morning we're going to be jumping back into Colossians. We're going to be in chapter 1, and we're going to see the Apostle Paul tell the church at Colossae, as well as us, that as human beings, we actually don't have to wonder. Whether we realize it or not, we do spend our lives separated by a wall in our relationship with God. So if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you, turn to Colossians chapter 1 with me. I also want to say, if you don't have a Bible, you're going to notice there are Bibles in some of the seat backs around you. If you don't have a Bible, take one home with you. That's our gift to you. We will replace it. We have more in storage. We would love to have you have a Bible. Colossians chapter 1, verse 21, we see these words. Paul writes this to the church. He says, "Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior." He uses this word that we don't use a ton, alienated. I'm a child of the 80s, so when I hear the word alien, I naturally think of E.T. or extraterrestrial. And if I let my imagination go, okay, what does it mean to be alienated? Well, maybe that means a spaceship hovers over someone, beams them up, and puts them in some kind of stainless steel mechanism and this alienates them or converts them into some kind of creature from outer space. An alien, in one sense, is somebody not from here or something not from here that doesn't belong here. But there's another sense of the word alienated that Paul uses here in this passage. See, alienated can also speak of a relational estrangement. Kind of that invisible wall that can be in a relationship whenever one person or the other has offended someone. And if you're a human being, which I believe you probably are, we don't have any aliens here today. Well, you know what this is like because we've all felt that break, that estrangement. Maybe it's a husband and wife who do what I would call like the morning dance. It's like you're not talking. You had a fight the night before. Now you wake up in the morning. You're both in the kitchen trying to get ready. And you're like, instead of saying, "Would you pass the peanut butter?" You just kind of awkwardly move around, pretending like each other aren't there because there's an estrangement. There's a relational problem. Maybe it's when you get a ding on your cell phone and you're kind of hoping it was that person that you just broke up with saying to you, "Hey, I want to make things right," but you feel that hollow disappointment when it's not. It's somebody else. And you're just reminded once again, there's an estrangement. It could be family dinner where there's an empty chair. And that's where the family member used to sat who got mad when there was the big blow up and they never come around again. We know what that feeling of estrangement feels like. And even though you might even be present in the same room, it's like there's an invisible wall between you. And Paul is saying that just as we can feel that in human relationships, there's an invisible wall that exists between us and God. It's a wall that is put there because of, as he says, our evil behavior, our sin. He puts it this way in Isaiah chapter 59. Not Paul, but Isaiah says this, "But your iniquities have built barriers between you and God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." Saying that our sins have built a barrier. Or in other words, like that fly, we have a wall in our lives built by our sin between us and God. A separation, a barrier. Now you might be saying, okay, help me understand, how does my sin build a barrier or a wall between me and God? Well, here's what you need to know about God. See, God is all holy. He's all good. He's all perfect. It's just his nature. He can't change that about himself any more than you and I could change our DNA. It's kind of like the song by Lady Gaga, "He was born that way." Or more doctrinally correct, he's eternally existed that way. And truthfully, we want a God like that, right? We don't want a God who is mostly good, who most days he's good, but every once in a while he just wakes up on the wrong side of the universe in a bad mood, and you better watch out that day. most of the time he's good, but every once in a while he just loses his temper and you don't know what's going to happen. We want a God that we can count on, a God who is consistently good. But here's the problem. Because God is all good and all holy, he can't have anything near him that is unholy, because it could contaminate him. It could make him impure. And the problem is, you and I are unholy. We're sinful. And because of that, our sin builds a wall between us and God, separating us from him. Think about it like this. I want you to imagine your favorite restaurant, your favorite restaurant. This is my example, so I'm going to pick a barbecue place. Okay, you look forward to going there all week long. You're finally there. You order. It's been a long wait. And finally, in my mind, I see a rack of ribs coming out, perfectly charred, smothered in barbecue sauce. You know, the bones are just sticking out a little bit. And I'm just so excited. I've been waiting for it. I tuck my napkin into my shirt because I make a mess when I eat ribs. And I just get the first rib cut, and I'm lifting it up to my mouth, and I see dangling from it a long, curly human hair. Now, if you're like me, you would probably think, I think I can do this still. But really, what do? You call the waiter over, and you put the rib down, and you say, you know, I'm really sorry, but this one contaminant makes the whole meal inedible. And that's the same thing in our relationship with God. One contaminant in our lives contaminates the whole relationship. One sin, one lie, one sexually immoral act, one selfish moment, one hateful word contaminates our whole relationship with God and alienates us from him, makes us estranged from him. But let's not kid ourselves. Because it's not just one sin, is it, when we look at our lives? It's a lot more than that. David writes in Psalm 40 some words that I think really describe the human experience. He says, "My sins have overtaken me, and I cannot see. They are more than the hairs of my head." He says, "When I look at my life, I see sin everywhere." In other words, he's saying, you know, I've taken that plate of my life, and I've set it on my lap, and I've gotten a haircut. And all of that contamination has just filled my plate. It's filled my life. And brick by brick and sin by sin, we've built a wall between God and I. Paul continues on in Colossians 1:21. He says, "You were alienated from God, and you were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior." Now, what does he mean when he says you were enemies in your minds? Well, your mind is the seat of what you believe. And there's two types of things that you can believe. Things that are true and things that are false. Truths and lies. So when he says that you're an enemy in your mind because of your evil behavior, what he's really saying is that you're an enemy in your mind because of what you believed about your evil behavior. In other words, you're an enemy because of what you believed about the wall that's in your life. Now, there are three things that people can believe about the wall that are lies. The first thing is this. Sometimes people in their lives believe, well, you know what? You're talking about this wall, but I'm not really that sinful. I'm not that sinful. In fact, you kind of stand where you can't see the wall. And you kind of pretend it isn't there. You're looking around. I don't see a wall. There's no wall. I don't see what you're talking about. And you convince yourself that there's really nothing in your life that could be so bad that it would separate you from this God who's supposed to be this really, really good guy. Or maybe you'd even say, well, there's not even a God to be behind a wall. And people do this in life in a number of different ways. Sometimes it's rationalization. Sometimes it's just saying, okay, well, you know what? You talk about this God and sin that's so bad, but really, would a good God really send someone who's just not that sinful to hell? Or maybe you'd say, you know what, isn't sin just some kind of fabrication of the powerful to oppress the weak for many, many centuries? It's like if you can just come up with some kind of an argument, some kind of rationalization, well, then you don't ever have to deal with the wall. And other people might say, you know what? Okay, maybe there's a wall behind me, but let's look at somebody else's wall. Look at that guy's wall. Man, he is so bad. He's already got 2 sixes painted on his wall, and he's in the middle of painting the third one. There's no way I'm that bad. This lie kind of sounds like, well, I know I'm not perfect. Have you ever said that? I know I'm not perfect, but you know what? I'm not posting racist comments on social media. I'm not perfect. I get it, but I'm not looting stores. I know I'm not perfect, but I'm not in the same-sex relationship. See, you stand where you can't see your own wall, but you're going to look at everyone else's wall and convince yourself, you know, other people are super bad. Well, me, you know, I'm not really that bad. Sometimes we respond with phrases like, if someone points out the wall behind me, well, that's just hate speech. If you call something in my life sin, I push back. Man, you're just being a bigot. Or my favorite is, that's being judgmental to say that I have a wall behind me. A lot of times I hear people say, well, you Christians, you're just judgmental. And yep, some of us are. But isn't calling somebody judgmental making a judgment about them? And so we kind of try to convince ourselves that if we can just reply with arguments or comparisons or just kind of fire back with name calling, well, we really just never have to deal with the wall behind us because we'll just go on the offensive. Now, there's a second lie that people tell themselves about the wall, and that's this. I'm way too sinful. I'm way too sinful. See, as where this lie is rooted in pride, you know, I think I'm better than I really am. This lie says, oh, there's no way. There's no way that I could ever get rid of this wall between us. It's rooted in shame. And instead of ignoring it, you stand so close to it. Man, all you can ever see is your failure. All you can ever see is the wall. All you can ever see is your sin. And no matter where you look, up or down, left or right, your entire life is defined by the mistakes and your failures. And I think this lie really does show up in our minds because we hear messages through it. The message that people can sometimes hear is, I will always be the person who. Do you ever hear a message like that in your mind? I will always be the son who couldn't please his father. That's just who I am. I will always be the girl who sleeps with guys in order to feel love. That's just who I am. I'll always be the dad who gambled away my kids' college savings. I will be always the spouse who cheated. I'll always be the woman who stole and lost her job. Have you ever heard that message in your mind? That's who I am, and that's shame. Another lie is, man, if people actually knew, fill in the blank, if people actually knew that even though on Sunday morning I was smiling, on Saturday night I was looking at porn online, they would just be disgusted by how vile a person I can be. If people knew what I did when I was on the business trip or whenever I was fighting in that war, they would reject me, they would hate me, they would think I was awful. If people knew that I had to take so many pills just so I could cope and make it through the day, they would just be appalled at my weakness. And the lie is, I'm just way too sinful. My wall is always going to be there. It's just who I am. Have you ever heard that message in your mind? It really makes you an enemy in your mind because your mind is kind of like prosecuting you all day long, making a case against you, presenting evidence you can't deny, declaring a verdict that just seems so right, and giving you the sentence of perpetual shame. Now, there's a third lie that people bring to the wall. It's the lie that, well, I can defeat the wall. Okay, I'm realistic to know that I am sinful. I've got some problems in my life, but I'm optimistic enough to have some hope that I can deal with this wall, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to overcome it. Surely God's a reasonable guy. So I'm going to climb that wall. I'm going to prove to God that I can overcome this. I'm going to prove my worthiness to him. So maybe you kind of build like an invisible ladder, and there's certain things that you do to try to climb that ladder. Every rung is like another good act. Like you came to church today, so that's got to count for something. And you know, you gave to that GoFundMe when that problem happened to that person. You try to help them out, so that probably helps you out some. And you know, your neighbor, they needed something from you, so you let them borrow your ladder, and you're just kind of building this case. I'm climbing the ladder, and I'm not going to make the wall any higher, You know, I gotta eliminate some bad stuff in my life. So I'm not gonna drink too much except on Friday night because I don't have to go to work on Saturday. You know, I'm gonna start being nicer to my kids. You know, I'm gonna stop slacking off at work. I gotta eliminate my sin, increase my good, and I'll defeat that wall. I want to put an image on the screen for you this morning. The words on that screen are German. It's Arbeit, Mach, Frei. In German, that means work will set you free. Work will set you free. In other words, work will liberate you, or work, or my effort, my religious performance will overcome the wall. Now, the interesting thing about those words are that they're on a gate into a place that was the complete opposite of freedom. See, the walls behind that statement aren't walls of liberation. They're walls of tragedy and death, because those walls are the walls of Auschwitz, the Nazi concentration camp in Poland, where it's an unfathomable thought, but 1.1 million people passed underneath that gate and that horrible, horrible lie, not to find freedom, but to find death. And you can take that down. But I think that many people are living under that same lie in their lives, that every day they're passing under a gate that says, work will make me free. Religious performance will make me free. I'm going to climb that wall. And it's a lie from the pit of hell that the enemy uses to oppress them and keep them from ever finding freedom. In a bit of tragic irony, the statement Arbeit macht frei, it's a twist on words for another German phrase, Wahrheit macht frei. And that phrase means the truth will set you free. If that sounds like it rings a bell, you might have heard it before, because Jesus said that in John chapter 8. Jesus said, the truth will set you free. So what is the truth to these lies? Well, we turn to Scripture to find the truth. To the lie that, well, I'm not that sinful. We turn to another letter the Apostle Paul wrote to a church in Rome. And he says this in Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 10. There is no one righteous, not even one. It's almost like he thinks you're making this argument in your head, like, well, maybe some. No. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away from the wall. All have been confronted with the wall, and they just turn away like it isn't there. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. In other words, he's saying, don't stand in front of your wall and think about the worst person that you could possibly imagine and compare yourself to them. Think about the best, the most holy, the most righteous person you could ever imagine, the best person you know. And here's a hint, it's not you. Think about them and realize this applies to them too. No one is not that sinful. To the lie that, well, I can defeat sin, I can just overcome it, I can be righteous enough. The prophet Isaiah shares these words when he's talking about the human condition. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6, all of us become like one who is unclean. All of our righteous acts are like filthy rags. And this is where, if you do a little bit of Bible study, you'll find that sometimes the translators of passages, I would say, they might tame it down a little bit. I think they might have kids, and they might think, I don't know how I'd answer this question if this verse was read in church the way it explicitly means what it means. So I will try to delicately explain what filthy means really. The word in Hebrew for the word filthy refers to the fluids that are produced during a woman's menstrual cycle. And the rags are what is used to absorb them. And it's not that Isaiah is saying that we shouldn't be righteous, but what he's saying is that when we bring our righteous acts before God, and we say, here, God, here, I'm climbing the wall, I'm gonna live up to it, I'm gonna make it over so I can avoid being separated from you, he's saying, well, that's like me having you over for dinner and giving you a used maxi pad as a napkin. And if that offends you, then you're starting to grasp how offensive our righteous attempts to satisfy God can be. So in light of this middle lie, maybe we are too sinful. It starts to look like it might be kind of true. Like maybe there is no way to overcome this wall. But when we go back to Colossians chapter 1, verse 21, that's when we start to see a glimmer of hope. Because Paul writes there, once you were alienated from God. See, once is past tense. Once you were alienated, once you were defined by your wall, once you were covered in shame, once you didn't even realize you had a wall of sin in your life, once you were just trying to overcome it unsuccessfully, you were tapping on that window, thinking you could earn your way through, not realizing that you were only going to wind up dead. Once you were. But in order for there to be a once, there has to be a now. And Paul doesn't stop writing. In verse 22, he says, but now he has. Once you were believing these lies, but now he has. And here comes the truth, and this truth is good news. He has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. And this is the truth that will set you free, is that once you had a wall, but now he has, through Jesus Christ, overcome that wall. Because Jesus is greater than the wall. And Jesus is greater than the wall because he came and he gave his life on a cross. And he confronted the lies that we believe with the truth that even though we might think we're not that sinful, Jesus is the only one who's perfect. He is the only one who is good. I think this is fascinating about Jesus. He had a buddy he hung out with every day. He was a fishing buddy, Peter. And Peter watched Jesus every single day of his 3 years of ministry. And Peter saw Jesus when things went wrong. He saw him when people tried to attack him and kill him. And after Jesus had died and risen again and went to heaven, Peter later writes this in 1 Peter 2:22. He says, Jesus was my friend and he committed no sin. Do you have a single person in your life that has been around you for more than a day who can say that you committed no sin? But Peter said, Jesus committed no sin. He was perfect. We are that sinful, but he was that perfect. To the lie that I am way too sinful, to the lie that there will always be a wall in my life, that I'm covered in my shame, Jesus said, I will take your shame upon me and bear the shame of a Roman cross. I will be naked in front of people and have that shame exposed. I will be mocked. I will be falsely accused. I will take every shameful act upon me. I will bear your shame so that you can be without shame. And to the lie that we can overcome the wall by ourselves, Jesus says, no, it takes a perfect life to overcome the wall. But I will live that perfect life. I will do for you what you're incapable of doing for yourself. See, Jesus, his story was once he was in a perfect relationship with God, and our story was once we were alienated from God, but on the cross, Jesus said, I'm going to trade you stories. Here, you take my story. You take my perfect relationship, and I'll take your story. I will take your alienation. That's why on the cross when Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was exclaiming the pain of the alienation he felt from God. Alienation that we deserved, our story that he had taken upon himself. And then he gave us his story. He said, here's my perfect relationship with God. I will take your broken relationship on me. And when it's completed, when I've done my work, he said, it is finished. And in those words, Jesus declared that he is greater than the wall. Jesus is greater than the wall. Now, here's my question to you. Is there a wall of sin still standing between you and God? You see, Jesus is greater than the wall, but we have to make the choice to accept that forgiveness, to let him tear down the wall and take the relationship with God that he wants to give us. Sometimes people think that just by coming to church, you're tearing down a wall, like God has an attendance chart in heaven. He's like, okay, you were there. 552 more Sundays and you'll be pretty close. Or, hey, you come and you kind of, you feel some good feelings, so God's doing something and he's making you right with him. Or you might think, well, I'm just gonna go be a better person, and eventually I'll kind of just transform into this place of good relationship with God. And he's saying, no, it's got to be a decision you make in your life. You have to choose to go from once you were to but now he has. And you make that choice by declaring to him, I have a wall in my life of sin, and the only way to overcome that wall is through your forgiveness. See, nobody here is so good that they don't need forgiveness, and there's nobody here that's so bad that they can't have it, because it's been won for you through Jesus. But we have to come before him and say, Jesus, forgive me, take my life, and I want to live it for you. And today I want to give you the opportunity. Today I believe there are people here that Jesus wants today to be the very last day in your life of once I was alienated, and he wants this to be the very first day in your life, but now he has forgiven me and reconciled me to God. So where you're sitting, I just want to ask you, would you bow your heads with me? And if you've never made that decision to follow Jesus in your life, I want to invite you to do that today. In a moment, I'm going to lead you in a prayer if you would like to do that. And there's no magic in the prayer. You won't find it written in Scripture because it just represents what's in your heart, just a way to help you express to God. If you want to give your life to him and receive the forgiveness that he has won for us on the cross by overcoming our wall, then I invite you to pray after me. Dear Jesus, I confess I have a wall of sin in my life. I ask that you will forgive the sin that is there. Thank you for the work that you've done on the cross, overcoming my wall. And I want to give my life to you, to follow you, just as you gave your life for me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
If you prayed that prayer, if you made that decision, welcome to the family of God. You'll never make a more important decision in your life. In fact, if you made that decision, I want to just ask you if you would be willing to text yes to Christ to 94000. And the reason we'd ask you to do that is so that we can pray for you and so that we can send you some information, some links to some information that'll help you take the next steps in your journey with Jesus. As Joe said, we're going to be sharing communion this morning. Before we do that, I want to just have us spend a few moments really pondering, reflecting on the price that Jesus paid for us. And then I'm going to give us an opportunity to pray. And so at home as well, you can follow along with us as we go through this process together. You know, Jesus, he went through so many things in leading up to his crucifixion during his trials, his various trials and arrest. He was mocked. He was made fun of, spat upon. He was beaten, punched several times. Scripture also says he was scourged. Other strips with metal and bone in it is draped across, whipped across the person's back. It's really designed to rip the flesh off of the person. Many people who received the beating that Jesus received died because of it. The pain would have been excruciating, really. But he chose to take that beating for you and for me, of his own free will. We certainly know that then he was crucified. Nails driven through his hands, probably 6 or 7 inches long, a nail through his feet. I can't imagine the pain. Really, crucifixion is designed to prolong death and pain as long as possible. So that physical pain that Jesus was enduring, again, would be indescribable. And yet he had other type of pain as well that he was experiencing. Joe talked about this already some this morning. Because the Bible tells us that Jesus bore our sin. He took our sin. This is what it says in Isaiah 53, We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him, on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. 1 Peter 2 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross. He did that for us. And the fact that he took our sin upon himself caused him to experience another kind of pain, because for the very first time ever, God the Father and Jesus, there was a separation there. Because Jesus was bearing our sin, God the Father could not associate, could not have a relationship at that moment with Jesus, because God the Father cannot have a relationship with sin. And that's why Jesus cried out in Matthew 27 that Joe talked about, my God, why have you forsaken me? He felt the pain of that separation. And then beyond the pain of that separation, he also experienced God's wrath. Romans 3 tells us that God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement. And in the New American Standard, they use a word called propitiation. And here's the meaning of that. I have it written for you. A sacrifice that bears God's wrath to the end, and in so doing, changes God's wrath toward us into favor. This really means that God's wrath was poured out. All of his fury, all of his hatred of sin was poured out upon Jesus. He poured it out until there was nothing left. Jesus took all of it, all of God the Father's wrath, for you and for you and for me. He took that wrath to the point where so much of it that there was none left. God put all his wrath on Jesus so that those of us that have accepted him, we no longer have to face his wrath. That's the truth of Scripture. His work on the cross, something we could never have done, it took down this wall between us and God. And as we get ready to take communion, it's a great opportunity for us to pause and pray. It's a great opportunity for us to, in that prayer, to reflect on the price that Jesus has paid for us. It's a great opportunity for us to, perhaps God is right now pointing out a sin that's in your life, that it's a great opportunity to confess that sin and ask him to forgive you. It's an opportunity to perhaps surrender more fully to him in a certain area of your life. And so I want to give you that opportunity to just spend a few moments in prayer silently. It's also such an opportunity to thank him for the price he paid for you. So would you bow your heads? Let's just pray silently together as God leads you. Jesus, thank you that you took down this wall that was between us and you. You paid our penalty. You paid the price in full. You did what we could never do. Thank you. We give you praise. We ask it in your name, Jesus, and we give you praise. Amen. The only requirement to take communion here at CAC is that you've accepted Christ as Savior. And so if that happened 70 years ago or 7 minutes ago when Joe gave you that opportunity, you're welcome to participate. If you give me a moment, I'm just going to first tell you how to do this, and then we'll do it together. So don't rush ahead. You have that cup, hopefully, or at home you have whatever it is, maybe a cracker, a piece of bread. So here, you'll see that there's, in the cup, there's two layers, right? There's a clear layer of plastic, And in just a moment, you can pull that back and you'll see a wafer. You can take that wafer and then you peel back the second layer and you can drink the juice. As we do this, let's remember what Jesus has done for us. Let's do that together. At home, would you join us? Finally, this morning, we want to celebrate. We want to celebrate because we know that on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead and was victorious over sin and death. And we share in that victory. Because of that victory, we can have a relationship with the God of the universe. He calls us his sons and his daughters. And we can call him Daddy. Amazing. Scripture tells us that we were once in the domain of darkness, but now we are in Jesus' kingdom because of that victory that he won. We are set free, and we want to praise him this morning that we're no longer bound by the chains of sin. He has won our freedom. And so would you stand, if you're able, this morning and join us as we worship the God who loves us. Thank you.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living no claim on me.
Let's sing that again. Let's sing it out.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe, and out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. No, Jesus, yours is the victory. free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
All right, Sundays like this are fun. Hey, listen, we want to let you know, if you prayed to receive Christ today or maybe sometime in the past, but you've never been baptized, baptism is one of the next steps. And we are trying to plan a baptism service, and as you can imagine, in light of COVID, there's some logistics that come along with that. So we're trying to get an idea of how many would be interested in being baptized at the next service that we have. So if you want to let us know that you're interested, would you go onto our website, butlercac.org, and you'll find a place where you can click a link to just sign up and let us know. We're trying to get sort of an idea of how many would want to do that so that we can get that planned. Let's go before our Father in heaven in prayer as we end. Jesus, we thank you that you are greater than the wall. We celebrate that today. We're reminded of in communion. We remember it through your word, God, but I pray that we will be a people that go out of these walls here and live lives that demonstrate that you are greater than the wall. God, give us freedom from the sin that has beset us. May we take the message of the gospel out of this place and into the community, into the conversations, into the relationships that we have, so that all of our community and all the world may know that you're not just greater than the walls here amongst our church family. You're greater than every wall of sin in the universe. In Jesus' name we ask that this will be accomplished through us. Amen. Have a great Sunday. We will see you next week. You.